Friends, God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Amen and amen. A few announcements for you, as of course you can see on the screens behind me. If you're not feeling well today, we encourage you to stay home. If you're already at home watching us online, then it's a little too late to get that info. But if you're also here not feeling well, we have plenty of spots within the churches who watch as well. We encourage you to wear a mask. I took mine off so you can hear me clearly. Otherwise, it's really muffled. But our most recent suggestions are for a church to not even sing. I'm not ready to get to that point yet. I may get in trouble. But I'll encourage us when we do sing to make sure we're bending down. Mask on, singing down towards the ground. It's tough to read the words, I know. But here's our choice. No singing, or singing, bow down with a mask on. I say we bow down with a mask on, and at least do singing in that regard. That's one reason why we've limited the songs. I was at the point where I started thinking, we'll do instead of two songs in the kids' message, three, four, five. But the CDC guidelines, more so Governor Wolf and our own denominational guidelines, are suggesting to us to limit, if not outrule, singing. So anyway, it relates to practice social distancing as well, which means 6 feet apart from folks who aren't part of your immediate family. Next stop, we do have live streaming options throughout the church here as well. So there's downstairs in the parlor. There's also not only in the parlor, but there's also in the library, which is right by that glass wall entrance there. We have those live streaming options. If you'd rather turn on your own TV, your own room, the youth room, the consenting school room, down this hallway you can use. There's downstairs an education room, and then I messed around with the TV and the fellowship hall, so that may not work so well for you. Oops. So if you want to use that one, it's down there, good to go. Except for the fact I'm playing with it for our 200th anniversary meeting right after church today. Next, of course, we want to be intentional about practicing good hygiene. So wash your hands, use hand sanitizer. The stations, thanks to Ross Vernon as well as Sue Vernon, are in a much better place where they actually give sanitizing fluid when you want. So thanks to Ross and Sue for that work. And two, make sure you use them. We won't be off passing off your plate. For many of us, this is an old announcement plate that said we do have the baskets at both doorways. And I will continue to say, because you continue to astound me by how generous you have been in the midst of the pandemic, how you continue to worship God through the giving of your tithes and your offerings. And so whether it's mailing in the check from your own home, at your financial institution, send the check, or gift, or whatever, let alone how many of you are giving online, through whether it's Vanco, or which is the online computer source, or the gift plus on your phone, you have astounded me with your continued worship, God, including God, your giving tithes and offerings. Thank you. If you're interested in between services at right around 10 o'clock, we wipe down the pews so they're nice and sanitized for after the 9 o'clock service. If you're interested in being here early, that'd be great. Many folks, including Bonnie Jordan, Paulie McHale, Chuck Orr, Linda Corner, and so many others have been intentional about cleaning. So if that's something you're interested in, we're here at 10 o'clock, wiping down the pews and whatnot. Thank you. Marvelous Mondays, Monday nights, 5 to 7 o'clock for students anywhere from 3 years of age through 6th grade. We have our oldest kids helping out with leadership. We have many adults who are willing to help. Friends, if that's something you're interested in, or for a youngster to be a part of, that's Marvelous Mondays here at the church, 5 p.m. You guys want to drop mints up here too, Susan, just in case. Awesome. Okay. I hate when that happens, especially when I get the tables in church.
Thank you.
We'll move on. That is pro tables. Of their behavior. We don't go anywhere else there. Sunday school is 10 o'clock Sunday mornings. There are adults downstairs. And this morning we had, for the first time in eons, we did have a time of fellowship. Prefab, what, post-its cakes? Little Debbie's, thank you, Ben. It's not like I had time to get one. Little Debbie's as well as coffee downstairs. So as we try to figure out how to be able to spend a little bit of time together safely, we did have that today between services. But Sunday school, as well as our kids, kids upstairs, adults downstairs, 10:10 Sunday mornings. And our Let's Give Thanks to Our First Responders dinner. We're looking for cookies to be brought in for that weekend. What's wrong, Kathy?
They're down there.
They're already down there?
They're down there.
So you mean they're extra cookies?
Yeah.
You're saying they're extra cookies, because I always need extra cookies. There are lots of cookies down there. Awesome.
We'll be delivering tomorrow, I guess.
Okay, so delivering tomorrow. All right, fantastic. So if we put our orders in to you?
Yeah.
I'm joking. They're going to go to the first responders, not to Pastor Brian, who doesn't need the cookies. Henceforth, they will be sent to our emergency responders to 7 different locations. To be intentional. I'm sorry.
Praying over them tomorrow morning around 10.
Well, you guys are good. Well done. So if you couldn't hear Kathy there, 10:15, they'll be praying over the cookies and whatnot that we give as a thank you to our first responders. In the past, we've had the meals at the church. We've had a sit-down meal together to intentionally, in person, say thank you to those who serve. But with the coronavirus, we're not able to do that. So our COVID team and many others have dreamed, or dreamt, whatever verbiage I should use, and came up with this plan to say thank you. So, so cookies, hurry up and get them in here. That's what I'm there. Well done. Friends, also, we'd love to be able to give as well either Hallmark quality or homemade cards for our first responders to say thank you for what they've done. I've seen a few of the cards made by our kids. Talk about great. So that's something in your wheelhouse, please. That'd be a wonderful thing. Our angel tree is downstairs. I'm going to shut up, though, Debbie. I think everybody else is very thankful for that. Ladies, if you're ready.
Hi, everyone. We're here from Mercer County Foster Care. I'm Debbie Eamon, and I co-work with Mr. Manning. Wanted to let you guys know that we do have our angel tree downstairs in Fellowship Hall. We did ornaments this year, so they're bright colored. There's a information on the back about when to return them, and my phone number and email address if you have any questions. We do service kids age 0 to 23 now. they just increased that to get kids through college. So if you get, if you want to get that, or if you're online, if you can contact me or the church, and we can get you information. Thank you so much for your time.
Ladies, thank you. There's also contact information on the back of those ornaments that are on the tree downstairs, if that helps you determine how to get in contact with Debbie as well as everybody else associated with Mercer County Foster Care. Foster kids are some of the folks who slip, or some of the people who slip through the cracks in the midst of Christmas, because not every foster home is much of a home for students. So that's one way to definitely share love of Jesus with kids. A couple more notes to make as well, my friends. Of course, our Christmas flower orders are due on December 6th, so you can find those sheets of paper in the doorways. Make sure you get those in as soon as possible, whether it be for the cyclamens, which are on the right, or the poinsettias that are on the left. So if you're interested, make sure you get those orders in. And I need to say thank you for how you've supported myself and my family in the midst of the, with my mom's death. My sister, who lives in Portland, Oregon, when she saw the stack of cards that had come in, she said, oh my goodness, whoa. Just, she was blown away by how many cards were received, let alone the meals that show up at the house. You showed incredible kindness to Tina and I, let alone my whole family. Some of you came down for visiting hours. Some of you came down for my mom's funeral service. What an incredible gift. All I can do is say thank you. You have truly put me in a place of wonder and awe by how you cared. Special note, too, also I need to say thank you to Dick Carlson, who was willing for months to be at, in an emergency fill-in basis. That's not an easy thing to do. Dick has that kind of giftedness. I'm not just saying that because you're here, Dick Carlson. Look at the 9 o'clock service as well. But has that kind of giftedness to be that flexible. Not everybody's got that kind of ability to just say, oh, I'll preach this morning. We're blessed with Dick Carlson, who does. I also need to make sure I say thank you to those who are involved with our ability to live stream. And so whether that would be Sandra Rogers and Jamie Segula, who have the details of how to live stream, let alone Alan Segula, our third grader, who made sure that we were live streaming on Facebook as well as YouTube for the 9 o'clock service. Then Annie set up for the 11 o'clock. I still don't know who turned on the 11 o'clock service. I don't know. I hear somebody did. Was that you, Patty? You have no clue? Somebody turned it on. Thank you, whoever did that. Thank you. Well, friends, that's where we're at this morning. Thank you again. Sue?
I would like to say thank you to Pat Confer
yeah.
and Bob Fowler. They passed out 290 candy bars for trick or treat.
For trick or treat. They wouldn't give me any.
There weren't many left.
Pat and Bob sacrificed their Halloween evening to be here passing out candy on behalf of the church. Friends, we have little kids who would say, they gave out full candy bars when they got to our house. Tina and I are not that generous. Thankfully, you are. Friends, why don't we greet one another with the love of Christ?
Girl, I think it's number 8.
Forever God.
God who is forever strong, forever faithful, we are reminded that when we leave here as well, we've got to determine what we will believe. So, Frank, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended to heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Friends, please be seated. It's time for a children's message. If our youngest folks would like to come forward, that would be great. If not, you guys are good. Awesome. Good morning, Mike. Come on up. We'll just sit up here. I'm Brian.
Signal from his microphone.
What's that?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think he forgot to do it. So I'll come back after I sing the glory portrait, and then I'll come back.
You're too? Yeah, they want to make him shoes that light up. Now, if there's no light up, I know the feeling. Yeah, I wish they had dress shoes that light up, though. All right, I have a question for you guys. Do you know what this thing is called? That I just took off my wrist? Eric, you got an idea? Yeah, actually not a bracelet. It's a watch. Ooh, you guys are good. Of course, it may look like a bracelet with like green stuff on it. But it's a watch. What's a watch do? Oh, it's going to turn numbers on. That's right. It's turned them on. It says 11:21. Somebody out there is going to say, hurry it up. You know what else it does? It actually tells us what time it is. So right now it's now 11:21 and 25 seconds. Did you know that? Now it's 28 seconds. Isn't that exciting? No, I don't think it is either. But, you know what, when I was younger, I'd have watches, and the batteries would die. What would that mean? It would just stop. Now, I'm like this one, Verizon just sent me a message. Is that great? We'll move on. So, it would have the numbers, it would just stop right there. There was one time I was waiting at the doctor's office, or the dentist's office, and my watch stopped. There was no clock in the room, and it just felt like it took forever to get in. Forever! I think I was maybe about your age, Bear. How old are you? 15? 25? 4? 4? You're tall for 4, man. I'm impressed. Okay. You're 3? You're 4 too? Okay. Wow. Wow. That's our ancient.
I'm going to turn 4 in 3 months.
You're going to turn 4 in 3 months? Wow. So that means your birthday is in like February? Yeah, or January. Who knows? Okay, we'll come to that at some point. Either way, my watch just stopped and I had to wait. Have you ever been someplace where you had to wait and it seemed to take forever?
Yeah,
I think
so.
At the darker place. Yeah, I know. I hear you, because that can be very warm. Bear, yeah. Do you ever get to a place where it just seemed to take forever? Your birthday's in November. What day? Because this is November. How many days? Do you know what day your birthday's on? No? Oh, it's in November? Okay. Gotcha. Sweet. So you guys have a birthday coming up soon, huh? So wait, that means you're going to go from 4 to 5? You're going to be old. I know. You're going to have to retire soon. Okay. We're done with that. So, either way, my clock stopped. I did the watch stop down. Waited. It seemed to take forever. And I think it was 3 minutes later in the dark. So it didn't take forever, but sometimes it can feel like it takes forever. And then you're going to hear sometimes teachers or parents or me say, well, try to be patient. It's easy to forget how hard it is to be patient. But the Bible tells us that one of the things God can help us do better is be patient. Because the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy, peace, and good job. Well, Patty did her homework this week. Adults, you'll see your assignment coming up. Because the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy, peace, and patience. that means they've got to help us wait a little bit longer. Now, I have something for you this morning. I actually got two things. Okay? But you have to wait for a second. You be patient. We'll find out. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you help us wait on you in your time. When we get impatient, help us to find strength in you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys are great. So here's what I've got here. We have here on CDs, we've got 17 Bible stories. You guys do have this exact one. Did you steal it from me? Okay, just check it. Just check it. You have our own, your own, our own. I almost said our own. Long week. Here's what I'm going to do. Give you guys one. All right? I'll bet your parents would just love to have three of these CDs. Here you go. Why did I tell you that? At Vacation Bible School, we'll play the music every day. I'll go home and search meaning of it. I don't wish that evil on you, but it's probably coming. So those are for you. Okay, it's the same CD for all three of you. But if you're like with many parents with kids and you lose the CDs, I don't know how that ever happens. I know Tuesday night's garbage night, that's a side note. But there we have that. Also, hope you guys are great. And I've got leftovers.
No!
Here we go. I've got leftover pretzels for you. But Barrett, I'll be right back. Do you trust me? Can you wait that long? I'm going to take you like 3 seconds. Ready? Count it out. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Longer than 3 seconds.
5. There you go as well.
All right.
You guys are great. Thank you. So, we have that song. Matter of fact, I was about to ask Merle to hit it. Guess who's also doing that sound booth today as well? We do have our song. You guys want to sing with me? Everybody here is going to sing because our adults just love this. Let's sing together. Ready?
Thank you.
for it. Let's praise God for who God is. And what do we need to be praying for? One, Lexi's family. Yeah, they are blessed. So Penny's daughter, Lexi, her father's father, Lexi's grandfather, passed away. So be praying for the art class. John.
On Friday, October 16th, the dairy farm family in Corey lost their home and their daughter perished in the fire. I'm going to be going there this afternoon for a benefit for them. I'd just like us to raise them up and pray for healing for their family.
Chuck, what's the name of the family?
Nickerson.
Thank you.
Hannah Jo Nickerson is her name. She was 14 years old.
Wow, so Hannah Jo Nickerson on the 16th of October lost her life in the fire, and the whole family lost their home. Okay, I'd be praying for the Nickersons. Chuck, thank you. Friends, is there anything else you want to thank God for? Praise God for who God is. Dale.
Terry had his surgery on his hip, and it came out all right, and his ankle's feeling good.
Thanks, Dale. So for Terry, Dale's brother, hip surgery went well, healing on the ankle. He's in Quality Life Services right now. Thanks, Dale. Friends, is there anything else you want to thank God for? Praise God for who God is. Sue. I've been really disappointed. I I'm disappointed in my friends on Facebook, even pastors, either gloating about their candidate one or candidates one, let alone also the overt, rude grumbling that's gone on, too. No sign is innocent in some regards, but my goodness, talk about just the ability to even win or lose well, let alone what direction are we going. Thanks, sir. Friends, is there anything else you want to thank God for? Praise God for who God is. And again, I cannot say it enough. Thank you for being here for my family. Friends, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Well, for some of us, it feels like this avalanche has hit us. And whether it be with the election and the reverberations afterwards of gloating or grumbling, we're feeling it, Father. For others of us, it's fear for the direction our country's going or where it has gone. For others, Father, the coronavirus, the power it seems to be exerting upon our lives is painful. To the point where it even sounds like it's becoming worse here on a local and national level in comparison to that. Father, we're coming before you in the midst of the worries and the fears that we have, the hurts that we have, the strife that we see around us. And clinging to Psalm 40, I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined and heard my cry. He lifted me up out of the pit, out of the muck and clay. That you, Father, are willing to rescue us out of the midst of the ugliness. That we're waiting on you, Father, to bring about an end to the coronavirus. We're waiting on you, Father, to continue to move and work in our lives so we can talk with other people without attacks. And Father, it's hard when we see such horrific things happen in our world, whether it be for Hannah losing her life in that fire from the Nickersons, let alone the family being at a loss. We pray for your provision. We pray for healing. We pray for a spirit of comfort and peace. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Father, when we see so much disarray on a national level, we're praying for peace here, Father. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Father, when we see horrific things like Lexi's grandfather surprisingly passing away, we pray for healing for the family. We ask you to be with the art blasters. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Father, we've seen your hand at work, whether it's healing in Dale's brother Terry. I've seen your hand upon in the midst of life lived with my mom's death and time and preparation. We've seen your hand at work, Father, for so many of our family members who have been protected from the coronavirus, who have somehow been able to keep their jobs in the midst of a downturn. We thank you, Father. We're praying for our local schools as coronavirus numbers seem to be growing. football players at the local school, and staff members at many local schools, including Dasa McKinney, were praying, Father, for healing. You're the God we're waiting on. But then, of course, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Jesus, you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. We come before you, Alpha and Omega, first and the last, asking for you to move and work in our lives as we cling to you. You are the solid foundation. You are the rock upon which we stand. We come before you now, Father. We come before you now, Jesus, asking for you to move and work as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, the scripture reading this morning comes from Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. As Chuck makes his way forward, you'll recognize this passage, as it always seems to come about when we pray for that ability or the need for us to forgive others. And yet there's more to it than just forgiveness. Morning, Chuck.
Good morning. Matthew 18, verse 21 through 35. Then Peter said to Jesus, Lord, how many times should I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Should I forgive as many as seven times? Jesus said, not just seven times, but rather as many as 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle accounts, they brought to him a servant who owed him 10,000 bags of gold. Because the servant didn't have enough to pay back, the master ordered that he should be sold, along with his wife and children, and everything he had, and the proceeds should be used as payment. But the servant fell down, kneeled before him, and said, please be patient with me, and I will pay you back. The master had compassion on that servant, released him, and forgave the loan. When that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 coins. He grabbed him around the throat and said, pay me back what you owe me. Then his fellow servant fell down and begged him, be patient with me, and I will pay you back. But he refused. Instead, he threw him into prison until he paid back his debt. When his fellow servants saw what happened, they were deeply offended. They came and told their master all what happened. His master called for the first servant and said, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you appealed to me. Shouldn't you have also had mercy on your fellow servant, just as I had mercy on you? His master was furious and handed him over to the guard responsible for punishing prisoners until he had paid the whole debt. My heavenly Father will also do the same to you if you don't forgive your brother or sister from your heart.
Friends, this is the word of God, the people of God.
Thanks.
Friends, let's stand together and sing together the glory of God. Friends, we don't get ours cleaned enough, let alone I'm not volunteering to come to your place. But we did get excited about cleaning up the house. It was a day I had to go to Pittsburgh and deal with my mom's estate or any other family issues. It was a day where Tina didn't have to run off and help her dad or her stepfather with their health stuff. It was a day when we weren't asked to babysit. It was a day when we weren't supposed to work. It was a day to take it easy, tidy up the house, make it feel livable. As I was doing my third load of laundry that day, yes, laundry. I know, I get excited for doing laundry too. I need help, I understand. Either way, there I was, downstairs doing laundry, and I heard this hissing sound. But I don't know if I can replicate it well. It sounded like the hissing sound from maybe air coming out of a tire. Maybe it sounded like the hissing sound of a hose that had a leak. You can hear the water coming out. I look into the second half of the basement. The parsonage basement is huge. The parsonage, which is owned by this church where my wife and I live slash we squat, is a glorious, a huge basement. It even has these 2-foot by 2-foot concrete footers around the base of the floor. A previous pastor put them in there, which meant that water does not leak into the basement. Other houses in Mercer are infamous for this, not our house, except one spot. Now, the same spot is where I noticed where the water was. But I heard the hissing over by where the water was, too. Being practicing my deductive reasoning, I snuck over there to see what was going on. There's this river of water coming from the spot where water always can come in when it rains. But friends, this was Friday. And it hasn't rained really since Friday, Thursday, Wednesday. And then my life's a real whirlwind. I can't keep track. But there hadn't been rain. And then I realized where the hissing was coming from was the box there. And me, being very smart, realized that that was the water meter inside the parsonage. And the water was sneaking out of there. Friends, it's my day off. I don't have to deal with that. It's been chaotic. I don't have to deal with water issues at the house. We call a plumber. What do? I call Brent Thompson. Here is another advertisement for Brent Thompson, 724 Plumbing. Not that I think I really should do that, but I just wanted to say that I'm not giving an advertisement at all for Brent Thompson, 724 Plumbing, who I called, texted him a video of the hissing sound by the water meter, and he never came to our house. He just called back and said, Brian, you got to call Aqua. That's on them. Now, Aqua's our local water folks in the area. Henceforth, they called Aqua. And I'm thinking, oh my goodness, do I have to turn off the water? What's going to happen here? What's going to happen with the house? Come on, we've got so much cleaning you want to do. We need to use the water. Bathing's a good thing, and you always know that you need water. Well, you know what I'm talking about, if you know what I mean. You need water for many things in the house. Spoke to someone from Aqua. They connected me to the service person. The service guy called and said, I can be there in 3 or 4 hours. Today, 3 or 4 hours? You sure? You can't be here any sooner? As I start to think to myself, no water for 3 or 4 hours. Can't use the bathroom, can't use the shower, can't really do much cleaning. What about drinking water? Oh my goodness, my world is going to fall apart. I know, friends, that seems silly, doesn't it? I've seen the videos when we've done the 30-hour thing with our youth groups here as well as other churches I've served. Kids around the world who do not grow up in the United States will often have to go cart water for their family home miles from a stream or a well. We've seen videos of kids working beside the dump, collecting scrap metal wearing bare feet, and on their way home carrying home water. And I'm complaining about going without water for 3 or 4 hours. Especially when I mentioned to the service guy that we were at home today, we were going to be without water. The shelf valve was easy to get to, and he said, all right, I'll be there in 30 minutes to an hour. He was there in 15 minutes. He was done in 15 minutes. We had water in 30 minutes. Oh, my! And yet, that waiting was maybe the worst part. When we talk about patience, we often focus on time, and yet the scriptures here get at so much more than just time and patience. For me, it was terrible, 30 minutes without water, but it really wasn't. So, Patty, if you're ready, who's pulling double duty this morning, what is patience? To cover a bit of the basics here, here we go. Patience is the quality of restraint that prevents believers from speaking or acting hastily in the face of disagreement, opposition, or persecution. When we talk about patience in the Bible, it's really not about tick, 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 tick. It's about, oh my goodness, I have to deal with them. I have to deal with them. I'm sorry, I'm trying not to point at anybody. If I do, I don't want to point at anybody. Oh, Kathy, I just pointed at you. I'm joking. We often can find it difficult to work with other people. The scriptures, when they speak about patience so much more, are talking about interactions with other people. The Greek word is, let's see if I can butcher it again this morning, makrophumia. That's not even how my professor in seminary would have had us pronounce it. But makrophumia, it's the word used in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23 for the word patience. Which, you know, Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23 sort of goes like this. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. I'll wait for you. Go ahead. Oh, is it patience? Because the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. Oh, okay, I'll wait for it. Ha, ha, ha. Yeah, the joke's never going to be funny. Moving on. Yeah, the fourth one listed is patience in Galatians 5, 22 and 23. The word there literally means long-tempered. How many of us could it be described of as being long-tempered? Your friends may call you long-tempered, lots of your family. Very few of us, I bet, whenever we get with the people who are closest to us, we can be described as long-tempered. It also can be translated as forbearance, endurance, perseverance, or long-suffering. And if you read through the Old Testament, especially in older translations of the Bible into English, you'll see long-suffering comes up again and again and again, especially for how God seems to deal with us, long-suffering. Patience involves waiting. So for the next screen, Pat, if you've got, therefore, brothers and wait, I'm sorry, I got the wrong one. Thanks, Pat, at least you're on the ball. This saying is reliable and deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and I'm the biggest sinner of all. Time out here. The Apostle Paul wrote 1 Timothy, a letter to shy, timid church leader Timothy. When he wrote the letter, Paul's describing about how he became a Christian. Paul, who was a church persecutor, who helped murder Christians and even held the jackets or coats of folks who were stoning Stephen in Acts chapter 7 to death. That Paul, who had this incredible Damascus Road experience where God appeared, Jesus appeared to him in the flesh with bright light, so much brightness that it blinded Paul. It changed his life. Paul's saying here, hinting at, I was a murderer of Christians. And God was patient with me. So time back in verse 16. But this is why I will show mercy. So that Christ Jesus could show his endless patience to me, first of all. So I'm an example for those who are going to believe in him for eternal life. That God showed Paul patience. And that God will show us patience. Interrelatedly, and at times it's also tick, 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 as God's waiting for us to maybe get our lives right or to change our thinking. From James chapter 5, patience involves waiting. Therefore, brothers and sisters, you must be patient as you wait for the coming of the Lord. Consider the farmer who waits patiently for the coming of rain in the fall and spring, looking forward to the precious fruit of the earth. You also must wait patiently, strengthening your resolve, because the coming of the Lord is near. From James 5, 7 and 8. So patience for us does involve that waiting, and I would suggest as well that God's waiting on us. For our patience is wise in heated situations. Hot heads stir up conflict, but patience, people calm down strife, from Proverbs 15, 18. And patience leads to abundant understanding, but impatience leads to stupid mistakes, from Proverbs 14, 29. We're starting to prepare my mom's house to be sold, and I will often find myself, I'm not being patient and planning things out. Even yesterday when I was down at her house, I'm up in the attic, go downstairs to the second floor, go to the kitchen, go to the basement, and then remember, I forgot everything I wanted to take to the basement up in the attic. Friends, the ladder to get up into the ladder, not steps, the ladder to get up into the attic does not like me as it wobbles back and forth. I put some of my mom's socks on the bottom of it so it doesn't slide too much. So if you hear about me in the hospital, it's probably because of ladder issues. That being said, I forget what I need to do because I'm impatient to get things done. We've been there. For some of us, we forget what we're doing in the basement trying to get something because we were rushing on. And that's not even the hint that this passage is getting at, with so much more impatience leads to true stupid mistakes in comparison to being patient with others. Preach the word. Be ready to do whatever, do it, whether it's convenient or inconvenient. Correct, confront, encourage with patience and instruction. But you must keep control of yourself in all circumstances. Endure suffering. In other words, be patient. Do the work of a preacher of the good news and carry out your service fully. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 2 and verse 5, the Apostle Paul, that same guy who helped kill Christians, is now telling Timothy how to be a preacher. And part of it is being patient with people. Not everybody hears you the first time, or the second time, or the third time, or the 41st time. And 1 Thessalonians 5:14. Brothers and sisters, we urge you to warn those who are disorderly, comfort the discouraged, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Why? We see it in Matthew chapter 18. You have the way that it's described, translated in our this CEB, or Common English Bible translation, read this morning. One guy owes 10,000 bags of gold, and that's the servant. And then the servant's buddy is owed, the servant is owed by his buddy 100 coins. So you've got 10,000 bags of gold, bags of gold. Man, I'm trying to get ready for flu season, huh? So 10,000 bags of gold, and the other guy owes 100 coins. What's that mean? One guy is hugely in the hawk, and the other guy's just got a paycheck, maybe the payback. Once we're given the 10,000 bags of gold by the master, it's okay, you can pay me back later. Better yet, you don't owe me anything. And then he goes off through the life, he owes 100 coins, and says, give me, hurry, 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 now. And the friend says, I can't pay you now. Prison. Wait, there's no waiting. Prison. There is no kindness. Prison. He doesn't practice patience at all. He's not bearing with his brother, or as Colossians chapter 3, verse 13 puts it, bear with one another. Where'd you go? Now, there you go. Colossians 3, 13. Be tolerant with each other, and if someone has a complaint against anyone, forgive each other. As the Lord forgave you, so also forgive each other. Be tolerant with each other, bear with one another. What's that mean? Knock it off. Patience means taking the time to care. And being patient with others, so much of that, friends, is not being riled up or angry or attacking someone else because of what they've done. The servant who owed 10,000 bags of gold, you owe me 100, off to prison you go. Lashes out in anger, lashes out in greed, lashes out quickly without any thought or care. How quickly can we fall into that? I've got to be honest, it has not been easy with my mom's death and everything that goes into it afterwards. I've had a year to get ready for mom dying. 12 hospital or ER visits and whatnot. 12 months of cancer and chemotherapy treatments that really didn't work. And yet, in the midst of visiting hours, which could be beautiful, there are some folks who are really rubbed me the wrong way. One person came in and said, your mother didn't suffer that long. Well, time out. It's been a year. Friends, she had multiple surgeries. You mean it wasn't long? I saw how many times she battled diarrhea, let alone 12 ER visits. She didn't battle long. Here's my response. Ready? When I do things right. Now, when I'm seeing you, and I may do that, and I'm having that kind of moment, I hopefully am not so rude that I breathe out like that. But I have that quiet time of, get your breath right before you say something. Be patient. Someone else came up to me, and they said, what, it's only been 2 years since your dad died? No, it's actually 8.5 years since my dad died. As the scabs were up a little bit. Or, you'll take care of it, won't you, Brian? Get dead blocks put on the house doors. You'll take care of seeing the lawyer. You'll take care of seeing this. You'll take care of seeing that. You'll make sure that all this is packed up, won't you? Those are just the ones that I had this week. Or the moment where a family member said, I just can't handle this anymore. When I needed them to be there. My instant response was to say, shake it off. But instead, me laugh and rubs me the wrong way still too, is at the visiting hours for my mom, more than one person came up to me and said, "Dad, I'd like to have that from your mom's house."
Seriously?
Can't you wait till after we take care of the funeral service? But instead of laughing at them or being angry, what's fascinating is when you take that moment, sometimes you can see that people are hurting. For some folks, it's because they miss my mom. For other folks, it's because they don't know what to do when they're grieving. For a lot of people, when you talk about the death of a parent, they are instantly transported back to their own parent. They're having a hard time being there for you when they transport there. Well, I take that moment to be patient and forgive. It's so much easier to not just lash out and say, "You want what from my mom's?" But instead, show grace. To really intentionally be kind. There are some folks who just do not know what the right thing is to say. And all too often, it's really at a setting like a funeral service, setting a visiting hours, it's more about saying, "I love you, I'm here for you," in comparison to having an answer. When somebody looks you the wrong way, when you feel frustrated, when it can be for me with the funeral service, or it could be with your neighbors because they don't rake their leaves, or maybe it's because their dog likes to use your yard instead of theirs. If it's your family members who seem to only call when they need money or want a meal, or they seem to need something else from you, or, "Hey, can you fix this in my house?" How do you respond? Because the scriptures here are reminding us the intentional practice and patience to bear with each other. In Colossians 3, it means that you're together. You don't just disappear. Friends, remember, for our sake, Jesus went to the cross to pay the price of our sin. Talk about pain, patience. What stood out to me yesterday in the drive back and forth from Pittsburgh to here was that Jesus was on the cross for 3 hours, at least 12 hours after he's arrested, if not closer to 15 to 18 hours after Jesus is arrested, he finally dies. 18 hours. If it was just to pay the price for our sins, it could have been like that. You have trouble being patient? The model for us is Jesus. If you have trouble being patient, the one to seek out help to be patient is this, Jesus. I would not encourage you to pray for patience because that all too often, maybe, just maybe, can bring up a whole lot of trouble in life. But when you sense that you need to practice patience, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, and what was that one?
Patience.
If it's the fruit of the Spirit, it comes from God, gives us that ability. If you're like me, you don't have a lot of patience within you, especially when I get a little cranky, or tired, or frustrated. But the fruit of the Spirit will move and work. How do I know? God gives it this week. There are days, I don't know how my tongue didn't say something that would have hurt someone else. That's the fruit of the Spirit, it's not me. Thanks be to God that God's willing to work in our lives. That God doesn't treat us like the servant who owed 10,000 bags of coins and ran over to his buddy and said, "Gimme, gimme, gimme," to the one who owed 100. Instead, God looks at us and bears with us. The model for us is to strive to bear with each other. So when your spouse is driving you nuts, or your neighbor, or somebody you wish would just move away, when your kids, or your parents, or your grandparents, or your grandkids are the kind that make you wonder where they came from or why you have to deal with them, ask for God to move and work through you. Because the fruit of the Spirit is patience. Amen. Would you pray with me? You can find the prayer on the screen behind me. But before we get there, our assignment this week is this. Learn Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23 by reading it every day this week. Okay, ready for it? Here's your assignment. We're going to get it done right now. So at least you know you did it one day this week. Ready? Well, let's read it. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace,
patience,
kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against things like this. And practice patience this week when needed and it's inconvenient. I'm not going to tell you when that's going to happen. You're going to know it. When you're going to have to wait for the doctors, you're waiting for the phone call, you're waiting for your kids, you're waiting for your parents, whatever it might be, you're going to have that moment when you're wondering, can they at Mercer figure out what they're going to do because of the coronavirus? Or at the school my grandkids are at or whatnot. You're going to have that moment. practice patients. If you watch social media, for instance, with the coronavirus or the election, we're not very patient. We don't bear with each other well. And I'm saying us as a society, not in this room. Be cautious, because all too often what we say or what we type doesn't disappear. It's much better to take that moment and ask God to move more through us. Amen. If you would you pray with me? Because that's where we're going to find our strength. And so I encourage you to close your eyes and turn your hands toward heaven and repeating after me to pray together. Friends, let's pray. Lord God, loving Father, I love you.
I pray this day
that I may live in your presence. And that I may please you more and more.
Lord Jesus,
I pray this day
that I may take up my cross
and that I may follow you.
Holy Spirit,
I pray that this day you will
fill me with yourself
and ripen your fruit of the Spirit in my life.
Love, joy, peace.
Patience, kindness, goodness.
Faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
I pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Friends, we're going to sing together Victory in Jesus. I encourage you, if you're able to one, stand up, two, put the mask on, and of course, bend down the same as we intentionally try to keep others safe. One of the weird things I'm finding out is, as I watch the NFL, almost every NFL player who's been found out the coronavirus is not showing symptoms. You may feel okay. That doesn't mean you may not have something that, unfortunately, you may share with somebody else. That's why we do this now. I'm so frustrated, I can't wait till we can get back to normal, if there's such a thing. But until that time, let's love one another enough to bear with each other as we put these things on. Let's stand together as we sing.
Thank you.
May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and empowering you to practice patience. May God give you peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen.